Barcelona is a city brimming with culture and cuisine. Being born and raised here, I'm proud to call it my home. But it's been a while since I've been here. I've been living in Manila for 12 years, and food has always been my way of bringing the spirit of Spain to the Philippines. Today, I'm happy and proud to share that from one small restaurant, we've grown to 6 concepts, including Tomatito, Las Flores, Rambla, La Lola, and the newly opened BCN. That's why, when I was invited to go on a culinary journey to explore the best of Spain, it was impossible saying no. Join me as I rediscover everything that Spain has to offer, right here on The Cross. In Spain, food is meant to be celebrated and shared. Staying true to that, I asked my good friends and business partners to join me in this food crawl. Social media influencer and endorser, who, unbeknown to most people, runs an agriculture business in the Philippines, Nico Bolsico. And renowned chef and restaurateur in Asia, who opened the first Tomatito restaurant in Shanghai, Chef Willy Truya. Barcelona is a coastal city with a beautiful beachfront culinary scene. So many great restaurants serving the best
chef, seafood. Tenemos hoy para comer que nos has preparado.
It is a sin to go to Barcelona and not spend time at the beach. So let's hit two birds with one stone. Come to the beach and have the best paella in Pez Vela.
Okay, guys, so we're here, Pez Vela. Amazing restaurant by the beach. Beautiful people, beautiful restaurant, beautiful food, and the master of ceremony, Chef Evaristo.
Chef Evaristo, the master
of the restaurant. Chef, ¿qué tenemos hoy para comer? ¿Qué nos has preparado? Explícanos un poco qué tenemos.
Os he preparado un plato estrella que es de aquí de Pez Vela, de Tragaluz. Unas almejitas con un poquito de picante hechas a la brasa.
¿A la brasa?
A la brasa.
¡Olé!
Es uno de nuestros platos estrellas.
Suena muy sexy. Ok, eso suena muy sexy.
Muy sexy.
¿Todos ingredientes locales?
Ok.
Okay. Se ha preparado en este caso un arroz de calamarcito, gamba y almejas.
Ok, eso suena muy sexy. Eso suena muy sexy.
No, no, no. Sensual.
Sensual.
Usamos un arroz de extremísima calidad, usamos una variedad bomba de ella de
tan ligero,
okay. El delta del Ebro.
Muy bien.
Si leéis el diámetro de la paella, es muy grande. Son muy excesivos, no tienen tomate porque no tienen pimiento.
Encantado. Y ahora, sientan ligero.
¿Cuál es tu plato preferido de estos tres? Si tienes que elegir uno.
Para mí los tres, porque los tres los he parido yo.
Muy bien. Esa es la respuesta.
Seguro que lo vamos a disfrutar. Encantados y bueno, y ahora le vamos a atacar a la comida.
Willy,
estáis en vuestra casa.
Muy bien, muchas gracias, chef.
Súper bienvenidos y cualquier cosa me tenéis por aquí.
Muchísimas gracias, chef. Muchas gracias. Adiós.
Willy, do the honors, Willy.
Okay.
The real master.
Here, the best of the best is the socarrat, which is on the sides of the paella, which you can see is a little bit more dark. This is the socarrat.
Socarrat.
That's the best part of the paella.
And this is just heaven on earth.
Let's just show how thin the paella is. The layer is really, really thin, and that's why we are able to achieve that burn at the bottom, but so nicely done at the top, no?
Look at this socarrat, oh my God, that's beautiful, Danny, you know?
Amazing, amazing.
That's not beautiful, that's very sexy, you know?
Amazing.
So since we start, you know, working in this project with Chef Willy, I realized that sensuality is very important in the kitchen, right? Am I right?
That's right.
When you put love, it shows in the food.
Yes.
He's putting the fifth gear already, this gentleman.
I'm just so overwhelmed. Yeah. This is my childhood food. Meaning, we are from Barcelona, and to see this on a table is like going back home.
Okay, let's start with the paella.
Let's go.
Ok, a ver la paella. Sexy dance.
Outstanding. I think it's super tasty, but we need to discuss, I think, other rice.
That it should be.
You know? Because this is something very, very Spanish, Italian also, you know?
Yeah.
Where out here, with the rice, the paella, with the rice al dente, a little bit hard, not totally cooked. You
know? A little bit.
So this is very different from other countries, especially in Asia, where the rice is, you eat the rice very well done. If it's not al dente in Spain, it's no good. So here, we got a clear example that Chef Evaristo is a master.
Yeah, and it's right what Chef Evaristo said. It's very, the flavor is very good, but it doesn't stay in your mouth like heavily. Like you enjoy it and it like it goes away. So
that's
it's like
right,
light. It's a light, very well flavored paella.
I think one more thing, I think it's something to we should comment about is the saltiness. In Spain, people eat salty. Mm. They like salty food. But in Asia, they would say, oh, it's so salty, you know?
Yeah, we use salt for most of our dishes.
Well, shall we try
the langoustine?
Shall we try the langoustine?
Mmm, so delicate.
It's like creamy.
It came out the whole piece, no? So nice.
Creamy and sweet.
I want more.
Nice.
Mmm, it's like creamy, like
smooth.
Yeah, very smooth. Creamy and, very and sweet a little bit. Sweet, elegant and delicate. It's time to try the clams now, you know?
Yes.
Go with your hands, no? I think,
we have to go like Viking style, like go all in, like
mash.
You can really see the size of these clams.
Mmm. Apa. Apa, five.
Mm. Mm. Wow. This is a party in your mouth, you know?
So tasty.
It's like sweet.
Yeah.
A bit sweet.
The tomato.
The tomato, I think, gives kicks that sweetness in the picture, but...
Oh my God, it's so nice. And a bit spicy. Ah, yes. I got a spicy.
And he said it's one of the signature dishes, you know, of here, of Pet Bella, you know? And I found it like really like a delicacy, you know? It really represents the Mediterranean, you know?
So I think we're here, it's like a whole experience. You are relaxed, you're in front of the beach. You can really enjoy good food, good flavors. If you are with good friends or family, it's kind of like the place to be.
Yes, and I think the beauty of this restaurant is that Barcelona has great weather throughout the year. And I think you can visit Pet Bella throughout the whole year. You come here, you enjoy a nice Sunday lunch. The way we do it in Barcelona, we have our paella with our family and friends.
We are family also. Perfect. We are friends and family.
Guys, let's toast.
Cheers. Let's toast for this amazing experience.
Cheers, guys.
Family time here.
Family, food, and friends.
Salud.
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 And now, we're jumping from the familiar paella dish to the not-so-familiar imaginative menu of this frutar. When we come back, right here on The Crawl. Every year, up to 82 million tourists flock to Spain. Here, you'll find the world-famous Sagrada Familia, a large Roman Catholic church designed by beloved architect Antoni Gaudí. La Sagrada Familia will take longer to complete than the Egyptian pyramids. It started in 1882 and is hoped to be completed in 2026, the centennial of Gaudí's death. The cathedral is a masterpiece in the making. In 2016 alone, an estimated 3 million people came to see the inside of this beautiful church. Gaudí disliked straight lines and angles because they don't often appear naturally. Instead, he based his design on the swirling curves of nature. The play of color, light, and space inside the church is a breathtaking sight. It is truly a testament of faith and beauty, one that's hard to find anywhere else in the world. Design, science, and cuisine come together in this next restaurant. Disfrutar means to enjoy. it lives up to its name by treating guests to an enjoyable and unique tasting menu. The end of 2015 not only marked the restaurant's first anniversary, but also its first Michelin star. This was followed by a second Michelin star in 2018. On top of that, Disfrutar recently ranked number 18 on the list of the world's 50 best restaurants. It's no wonder that dining here requires booking months in advance. Chef Willy will be joining the chefs in the kitchen to prepare the exciting dishes, while Nico and I wait to taste them in the dining area.
We're here with two chef owners, Mr. Chatruk and Mr. Castro, and we're ready to learn and understand what amazing kitchen they are doing right here. ¿Para qué el nombre de Disfrutar?
Bueno, primero se tiene que entender que primero hicimos compartir, ¿no? Compartir, este nombre transmite mucho, ¿no? ¿Y qué nos transmite? Lo que hacemos en medio de una mesa es compartir experiencias, emociones, alegrías y la comida en Cataluña. A partir de ahí, cuando llegamos a Disfrutar, queríamos, empezamos a hablar, ¿no? Este nombre es lo que queríamos transmitir, Disfrutar, ¿no?
Guys, what do we got here, you know? Wow. Boom! Woo! This is too sexy, you know? How do we make these magic olives? Oh, what is this?
Silicona. Y con eso nos permite hacer formas de lo que queramos y hacer miméticos.
Esto es un líquido que hemos rellenado, lo hemos congelado.
Amazing. It's like an ice cube, but with the shape and flavor of an olive.
La diferencia es que lo vamos a bañar con manteca de cacao de color verde. Una vez bañadas, las dejaríamos descongelar.
Then the outside is sealed because of cocoa butter, and inside the ice is melted and it becomes liquid and sealed outside. So when you eat it, it pops. Boom.
What do we have?
This is Vicente. Vicente, right?
Yes.
Vicente.
The enjoy of the olive.
Okay.
We suggest you start with the green.
Okay.
Then you eat the black.
Okay. Okay.
This is so delicate. You eat in one bite.
Okay.
Okay.
You start, I start.
No, we're gonna do it this way. I'm gonna feed you and you're gonna feed me.
Okay, I go here. I go here. Okay. This is sexier than Chef Willy.
Wow! That doesn't exist. I don't think there is anything sexier than Chef
Or Willy. Close to. We must admit that we felt that cocoa crunchiness, and as soon as that popped, all that cream olive.
And the taste still in my mouth.
Bloated.
Okay, let's try the black.
Now that was a curveball. It doesn't taste like a black olive.
It's orange. You eat the green one and taste like an olive, and then when you're getting the black one, that in your head you're expecting an olive taste, kaboom! What happened? It tastes like, okay, we're moving.
Explosion of oranges in your mouth.
And now we follow with what Vicente said, is licking the spoon.
Okay, go. The orange blossom, fantastic. So rich, so elegant.
Wow. Can you explain why elegant?
Because it's so smooth. It's velvety. When it goes through your tongue, what an experience. What a great way to start.
This is a technique invented here, 2017 technique, which is we put the pearls, you know, in this algae bath, and it jellifies, but when you put it in your mouth, it pops, you know? So it pops like a little pop, like purr, 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 purr. So it's magic.
Lo bueno es que podemos cambiar sabores, tamaños, lo que decimos, y te puede recordar al trencadís de Gaudí.
Imagine this in your mouth, it's a party in your mouth, you know? Bam! This is not cooking, this is art.
Oh, wait, time stop right now. What is this?
Now you can drink cava.
Vicente.
Okay. And okay. On the top, we have a corn with specification.
Okay.
And then we have a foie gras liquid. Take with the fingers, with the base.
Okay.
One bite.
No, two or three bites.
Okay, let's go. Let's give it a try.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
He said two or three bites, okay?
Okay. You can feel how the corn is popping. You can feel how the foie is melting. And then the crispiness of that last, you know, bottom layer makes it so flavorful.
Everything he says. it's amazing.
A nosotros siempre intentamos pues que haya el efecto de la sorpresa, ¿no? Que sea diferente, ¿no? Tenemos estos macarrones, es un macarrón que no tiene harina, no tiene huevo, es un macarrón hecho con caldo de jamón.
Hacemos un caldo de jamón, le añadimos un gelificante capa que sale de las algas y una vez hervido ponemos estos hierros en agua y hielo, automáticamente gelifica la parte que toca el hierro.
Hey guys, you know, these guys, you know, they're teasing me. They say, Willy, do you know how to make macaroni carbonara? I say, like,
macaroni.
I used to know, you know, but I don't know this super sexy carbonara here. I'm gonna be able to do it, but let's try. This is, we have a pork belly cooked with a little bit of its own fat.
Y la salsa carbonara en espuma para que sea más ligera.
Esto es importante porque en nuestra cocina el menú es largo. Hay entre 25, 30 degustaciones distintas. Y nosotros lo que queremos es hacer unos platos que sean muy intensos de sabor, pero las cantidades no pueden ser muy grandes.
So now we're gonna put 10 macaronis here. I'm gonna plate this super amazing piece of art. So now the next step with the carbonara foam, this would be a part of the dish done by the waiter. This is poetry, guys, you know? Art on the table, guys.
What do you have here, Vicente?
Oh, Vicente.
Here we have our macaroni carbonara. And we finish with the carbonara foam.
Okay.
And parmesan cheese.
Now, look at this. Look at this sexiness. And pepper. Let's go. Smells amazing. My God. The best part is you taste the carbonara. But it's not carbonara.
Correct. And the best part of it is that it feels so light. Mm. It's not heavy. But the pasta, it feels al dente, but it's soft at the same time. A bit more, Nico. Mm. You can get to try. Wow. What an amazing experience.
Insane.
Indeed, we are enjoying, we are disfrutando.
Disfrutar uses the element of surprise to give diners an enjoyable experience. Now, another way to enjoy food is to pair it with a good glass of wine. We'll be heading over to Bodegas Codorniu to see the intricate wine production process. When we come back, here on The Crawl. Spain is the third largest wine producer in the world, making it a wine tourism destination. Here, you'll find Bodegas Codorniu, the world's oldest and second largest producer of bottle-fermented sparkling wine, known as Cava.
Okay, good morning everyone. We are here in Cava's Codorniu and we are here with Vicent, our tour guide for today. Good morning, Vicent.
Good morning.
Welcome to Codorniu. Thank you for coming.
We are really looking forward to this visit because we know that Codorniu is an institution in Sant Sadurní d'Anoia. So thank you so much for your time.
Well, Codorniu is the oldest family business in Spain since 1551.
Wow, 1551, guys. Wow.
How many generations is that?
1551. 18th generation.
18th generation.
18.
Wow. It's 100% a family-run company since 1551, as I told you. The first owner, the founder, was Jaume Codorniu, who already produced wines in this property.
Wow, fantastic. And I noticed also that the buildings are very nice, no? The architecture.
Well, in fact, most of our buildings were designed and built by important Catalan architecture.
Okay.
Puig i Cadafalch.
Oh, Puig i Cadafalch. Wow.
The work started in 1900 and finished in 1915.
Nice.
He was like a good friend of Gaudí or like or from
he
the same.
He worked together. He worked together.
He worked together with the Gaudí, yeah, right?
Yeah. You can tell.
You can tell with the shapes, no?
Yeah. You can see that the style is very similar to the Gaudí style.
So it's a modernist style, right?
It's modernist style.
Amazing. And the gardens are really beautiful. It feels like it's like the Napa Valley of Barcelona in a way, no?
And we have been the the first Cava Prusa introducing Chardonnay for the Cava production. Well, we are exporting almost 50%. The rest is consumed in Spain, but mainly in Catalonia, because in Catalonia we drink all year round.
Actually, you can double. Get your cava in Manila, right?
They're like throughout the whole Southeast Asia, Japan, correct. You're a great big producer of cava and an ambassador also of this region abroad.
This building used to be the pressing area until the end of the 1960s.
Okay.
And now we do press the grapes just in front of this building.
Okay. Wow. Beautiful. Yeah. So, are we going to have a look at it?
Yeah.
Fantastic. Okay.
Wow.
Wow.
One of the four presses that we had here.
Okay.
And we used them until the end of the 1960s. Each press pressed approximately 2,800 kilos at once.
How many kilos?
2,800 kilos at once.
Almost 3,000 kilos? Okay, so where are we now, Vicent?
Well, we are now in a special place.
Okay.
It was here where we start to produce the first bottle of cava.
Okay.
In those days, it was called champagne.
Okay.
About 1872. When Mr. Josep Raventós produced the first bottle of cava.
1872, guys.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
Okay, so now let's go to the train.
And now we try this.
The ghost train.
Hey guys.
The game is touch as many cavas as you can. Ready? Catch it.
Right. Yeah.
On your hand.
Now here in a tasting room with a winemaker, with a cava maker, Mr. Bruno. Thank you so much, Bruno, for welcoming us. And now I think it's time to have a taste to some of your excellent cavas.
Thank you for coming. And we have a super tasting, the best product we have. The most important thing for me as a winemaker is that we are working from three different vineyards, big vineyards. We have one vineyard for Chardonnay, we have one vineyard for Pinot Noir, and we have one vineyard for the indigenous varieties, Macabeo, Charalho, Parellada.
Is that for the quality, for traceability? Why is it the reason?
It's for the quality, for the traceability, but also we have to offer to you the same profile.
Consistency.
Consistency year after year. Okay, the first is Clásico.
Okay.
Clásico is made with Macabeo, Charello, and Parellada.
Those are the indigenous grapes.
Indigenous grapes. And we are working with these grapes from 1872. It was the first bottle cava made.
So tradition and quality, we're talking here.
Okay, this one is very fresh.
Yes, very easy to drink.
Very easy, it's very fresh. You have some notes of apple.
Yeah.
It's like cider.
Yes.
Ciderish. No, it's ciderish, yeah.
Okay, the second bottle is Ana. Ana de Codorniu. We are producing Ana in the last 34 years. And Ana has been always with a very special blend, 70% Chardonnay. And 30 Macabeo Charello Parellada.
The first one was even light also in the nose, but this one right away, you can feel it.
The Chardonnay is on
the left of the Chardonnay.
Yeah. You feel the Chardonnay.
You can feel the Chardonnay kicking in there.
What I think is interesting in this one, that the first one, of course, you had the apple, you know, the fresh apple, but this is reminds me more when, like, manzana al horno, you know, the oven roasted apple. You know?
Yeah.
This Ana. Ana Rosé. Ana Rosé is a blend between Chardonnay and Pinot Noir.
Okay.
And we have the biggest area of Chardonnay in Spain. I will show you that a map of Catalonia, the area where we are now. It's like something like this. We'll press the grapes here, the Chardonnay. We'll press the grapes here, Pinot Noir. I will press the grapes in San Sadurní, the grapes from this area. And we will transport the juice till here.
Without fermenting, yet?
No, juice, without, before fermenting.
So it's a temperature control trap, right? Because otherwise it would start the fermentation already, maybe,
you
know?
Very well the system.
This was a little bit like orange, you know, like a little bit of orange notes.
And,
orange skin.
And sherry notes.
Yeah. Ah, so yes, cerezas, yeah.
This can be for breakfast.
You know, cava has been something that we've had ever since we were kids at home. It was part of our Christmas celebrations. It was part of... Actually, it's a great excuse. Any celebration is a great excuse to open a bottle of cava,
every,
no?
Every day is an excuse. Reina Maria Cristina's Blanc de Noir. It's white from red variety. We have aged 2 years in the bottle.
And why sometimes the Pinot Noir, for example, is red color and some other times it's white color, like in this case?
If you don't have maceration with the skins and the juice, you will have white wine.
Ah, wow.
If you have maceration, a short maceration, you will have rosé wine. If you have all the fermentation with the skins, you will have red wine.
So it's the skin that gives the color.
So Bruno, we would like to thank you for all the time and that you have given to us.
Wow.
And perhaps Willy, Nico, we could toast.
Yes.
No, for, to Codorniu and
no,
to Bruno.
And Bruno for this
please.
Masterclass.
Thank you so much.
See you soon.
See you soon in
please.
Asia.
Please. We're here, Asia, waiting for you. Thank you so much, Bruno. Thank you so much.
Learning the intricate art of winemaking has given us a greater appreciation for wine. Now, we're off to a greater appreciation for Barcelona by eating and drinking where the locals go. More food to taste, people to meet and places to go, right here on The Crawl. We just had a behind-the-scenes look at the art of making cava. Now we're moving on to another staple of Spanish cuisine, tapas. Tapas are small savory dishes of all sorts of food like appetizers and snacks. They are a central element of Spain's culture. We're joining Devour Barcelona to explore the three of the most unique tapas bars in the city.
Okay guys, so we're here in Charcuteria La Pineda. Something very, very special. What's going on here? What do we have here? What are we going to enjoy?
La Pineda is nowadays a pretty unique place in the Gothic. These places produce their own wine, their own vermouth, that is what you're going to try today, and have a lot of meat and cheeses. That is the specialty. So, beginning with the vermouth, it's an Italian drink, in fact, that was fed. So they decided to prepare it in here. Probably you know vermouth by martini.
Yes.
It's totally different, as you can taste.
Yeah, the taste is
a little bit burned, maybe?
Burned, yeah. It's very particular.
Following with the cheeses, we have from two places, more or less. The darkest is the famous Manchego cheese. Manchego cheese is from La Mancha, that's why we call it like that. It's cheese.
This one?
Yes, this that one. You can taste now.
Go ahead. This is my therapist.
Okay, what
that is goat cheese.
Okay.
It's pretty strong too, but less cured, so newer or youngest. No, thank you. And of course, then we have gorgonzola or what we call blue cheese. And finally, was the jamón. jamón ibérico, Iberian pork.
You can tell the beauty of this chorizo. Beautiful.
Mamadera.
And the flavor, it's so rich. Very nice.
Wow. Very good. Awesome. Delicious.
Very nice. So, for now, we are going to continue eating and enjoying a little bit more.
Hey, salute, señor.
Salute. Thank you so much. Okay, guys, so we're here in Bar La Plata. So here you can see the beauty of the boquerones fritos. The nice, correct.
This is really typical from Andalucía. And it's fry, because it's fry and so tiny, you eat it whole.
Okay, how about the butifarra?
A butifarra is how the Catalans say sausage. So any sausage is going to be a butifarra.
So like the flavors are very strong, but they don't last in your mouth for too long. You really enjoy the ingredients, and it's very simple. That's what I love the most. There's no too much sausage or too much elaboration. It's just what you see is what you get. And the flavor that you're expecting to have is exactly what you have when you bite it. Papa, las anchoas.
Ole, Pepe!
Ole.
Gracias, Pepe.
Guys, anchoas. Look at this size, this perfection, you know?
A filet.
This is a beautiful filet. This is like...
the perfect mustache.
It's like a piece of art, you know? Let's see the salt level and the texture.
Let us know, Willy.
Yeah. See?
Good. Nico, proceed.
Bueno. I haven't eaten enough yet, so...
Please. Anchovies are one of my favorite tapas in Barcelona. Mmm. Wow. Okay. Guys, I think it's time...
to cheers.
For a toast. For bar, to Bar La Plata.
To Bar La Plata.
La Plata for Mr. Pepe.
Barceloneta.
For Pepe, gracias.
Pepe,
and
gracias.
To Pepe.
Guys, this is art here,
Pepe.
Pepe, muchas gracias.
Salud, muchas gracias, Pepe.
Pepe, Pepe. Gracias.
Salud, salud, salud.
Por La Plata, por mucho.
Por La Plata.
Por La Plata.
So we are in Bodega La Palma, our third bodega today.
And in my opinion, this is one of the best kitchens in Barcelona. The food here is amazing.
Beautiful. What do we have here, Veronica?
We have here one of the specialities of this restaurant. That is the cheeks of the pork.
Yes.
But the nice thing about this dish is that this that you're seeing here is not potato, it's apple.
Oh, wow.
So
apple,
it's made with a partially sweet sauce. Yeah, and we call it meloso de carrillera melosa.
Comes very tender.
Yeah, I can share with you. Sit down, please.
I tried many times.
You want to sit down?
Thank you very much, Nicole.
You can tell right away as soon as you cut it that it really melts. It's really so tender, no?
Thank you, sweetie.
You're welcome.
It's heavenly tender, you know?
Yes.
Yeah, that's amazing.
I could describe like heavenly tender.
it's not very porkish.
Oh.
It's very soft,
and it's
the
not
flavor.
Really sweet.
It goes very well with the wine.
Definitely.
Chef, muy rico eso,
Muy bueno.
Very yummy,
chef.
We were
congratulating
the chef.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Actually, we should call the chef.
Stars.
Call the chef. Chef, we want to congratulate you.
So, ladies and gentlemen.
The artist behind the dishes. We're going to all cheers.
Cheers.
Muchas gracias.
Ole, ole.
Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias.
Salud.
Espectacular.
I think it's time to go to our next adventure. There's more happiness, there's more love.
But I will need to go for a bit. That's the sad part. Like, now we need like a very dramatic song.
Yeah.
But I'll be back in Madrid with you guys, okay?
So, Veronica, thank you so much.
It was a pleasure.
The Bauer Tours, represented by Veronica here.
Thank you.
Excellent job.
Thank you, guys.
The Bauer Tours.
Your tour.
Veronica, thank you so much. We have to give an applause to Veronica. Woo! Thank you so much, Veronica.
With great food and even better company, Devour Barcelona has left us with full hearts and empty plates. And now that we've devoured our way through Barcelona, it's time to take a short train ride to Madrid to visit the world's oldest running restaurant, right here on the crawl. Is a melting pot of cultures and a wide variety of dishes. One of them is Castilian cuisine, typical to the region of Castilla y León. The city is home to El Botín, a restaurant famous for its rustic Castilian cuisine. Founded in 1725, El Botín holds the Guinness World Record as the oldest operating restaurant in the world. The González family has owned and operated the restaurant since the early 20th century. And we are very lucky to be welcomed by Raquel, from the family's fourth generation of owners.
Okay, Raquel, your great grandparents.
That's correct.
That
Amparo
were
and Emilio.
Amparo
and Emilio.
Ole, ole. We can see here the oven and all the cochinillos ready for today's service.
Oh my God, there's so many inside, right?
Wow! 14 pigs inside.
Wow!
The oven. Wow! Goosebumps, goosebumps, guys. This is where Hemingway used to sit.
This was his table.
Oh my God.
He was sitting right over there, eh?
Yeah.
Here?
Wow.
Hemingway's corner. What an honor, Raquel.
Here we have some signs of the kings of Spain.
Wow.
Spanish royalty giving thank you, or saying thank you to the owners of Botín for the great meal they experienced. Wow. Wow, wow, wow.
And here in a little corner, we have a cute present from one of the painters of Disney that made
Disney.
A little Mickey Mouse for us.
Whoa. No.
That's so cool.
Wow. And here we have Mickey Mouse holding a tray with a piglet.
From Segovia.
From Segovia.
Ole!
Very good. Okay, Raquel, what do we have? Think this is what Willy is constantly saying. This is a museum.
Yeah. This is a museum.
Meaning how lucky you are to have a restaurant with so much heritage.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Amazing.
El Botín's specialty, cochinillo asado, or roast suckling pig, is a famous Castilian dish. It is made from pickled meat coated in butter, with pork fat, a bit of laurel leaves, and twigs. The dish is traditionally prepared in an earthenware pot and served hot with a crispy crust.
Raquel, is this beautiful cochinillo, is it the signature dish from Restaurante Botín?
Yeah, it's our signature dish and it's done in the oven from 1725, as you said before.
So the oven, the same oven where they cook it, is the same when they founded the restaurant
exactly.
In 1725?
Yeah.
So the oven, they've been using it for almost 300 years.
Almost.
Every day.
Yeah. Non-stop.
Non-stop?
So now we are going to see how a professional Botín waiter cuts the cochinillo.
Look at that, you know. It seems easy, you know.
Later,
seems easy.
Get to the middle.
Feels like butter, no?
Yeah, it's
so butter. Tender, no?
Yeah.
I don't know if you are able to appreciate this, but while Alex is cutting, I can hear how the skin is making all those noises because it's so crispy and golden crispy.
It's cracking.
It's cracking crack, crack, all
crack,
the
crack,
time.
Crack, crack, crack.
Correct. It feels so yummy in the ear. Correct. I agree. Wow. Wow, look at this. I think, Raquel,
yes.
Why don't you join us and enjoy this feast? Please?
Thank you, guys.
My goodness, and the smell and the colors, meaning so...
Yeah, I mean...
I'm overwhelmed.
It's like the layers, you know?
Look at these layers.
Are we talking about layers of happiness here or what, you know?
My goodness, and what best to pair this cochinillo with a glass of Tio Pepe dry sherry from González Bayas. To Botín, to Raquel.
For this legacy to continue for more and more generations, right?
Salud.
Legendary restaurant.
Salud, Raquel.
Salud.
Okay, guys.
Should we dig in or what?
Time to go and try it. Let's go.
Layer by layer.
Oh my. Oh my. This is like a symphony. Oh my goodness. Hear that crack, crack, crack happening here. Oh my goodness. I'm gonna start with the skin. Sorry, guys. I'm gonna start with the skin because just look at the skin.
You see the.
Crispy outside, tender inside. Amazing. Amazing.
Wow.
Amazing.
I love to taste that wood, huh? That woody smoke, saro, from a 1725 oven used every single day for almost 300 years.
Raquel, what can we say about the potatoes?
Well, they're roasted also in the oven, so they are also tender. Mm.
And it balances a little bit the taste, no? Mm-hmm. You can feel the richness of the cochinillo flavor, but then a little bit of potato cleans a bit your palate for your next piece of cochinillo.
Go ahead.
Because...
We don't even want to speak, you know? We just want to be munching it, you know?
What's the secret, Raquel? What's the secret for you to prepare this amazing cochinillo?
Well, we have a lot of people from the same family, that's true, in our kitchens. And for example, the cooker that just prepared this, he's from Philippines, and he's been here 15 years already.
It's very elegant and lean, you know, like it's not over fatty. Yes. It's got a good ratio, good layers of happiness, of fat to meet with the crispy skin. Yeah. And it's not porky at all, you know? It's a light fat, you know? That sometimes, you know, like we've tried other cochinillos that they are overly fatty and they taste a little bit porky, you know? Mm-hmm. But this is just like, it could be like a baby lamb too, you know, a little bit, you know? It's just very, very elegant.
Okay, guys, so I think it's time to, again, toast to Botín. Thank you so much, Raquel. It was an honor.
Thank you, Raquel. Muchas gracias.
It was a great honor
to be part of this experience, to be able to enjoy the cochinillo. Salud. Time is sacred, as the saying goes. But for the Spanish, life is sacred. So it is meant to be enjoyed. We've seen this in how the Spaniards patiently prepare their food. Savor it with their communities. We'll be exploring more of Madrid and meeting up with Nico again along the way. Don't miss the second part of our food crawl in Spain, right here on The Crawler.